Okay. So,
I am pleased to be here. This is a place I come very often. I am pleased to be allowed to speak because usually it's not necessarily the case. And this time I have got the shortest lecture of the school, which means that the organizers have decided that the time for the lectures is inversely proportional to the age. So, that's the okay. So I am going to speak of somebody who I assume that very few among you have ever heard of these materials, which are cobaltates. I would like to ask if somebody has heard about these materials, can he just put hands on? Three, four, oh, five. Good, okay. But still, it's 5/50, so it's 10%. So I think I have to do a big introduction. And the work I am going to present is a work which has been done, it's already 15 years of work with many people. Of course, I will not describe the whole thing. I'll try to be sharp and to go directly to the interesting points. But I have to quote the condition in which this work has been done. It has been done in the NMR, what was at the time the NMR group, which I was leading at the end of my career, I would say. And collaboration with a Russian group who visited us many, some of them visited us many times. In fact, Irek is nowadays a member of the group. And things have been started, as you can see, from the first papers in 2004. And there is a list. I am not going to explain all that, of course, but I am going to pick the important points here. There is a renewal which comes from the arrival on the market of this young student who has done his PhD 3 months ago, and he's still working very hard. And the things that have been done are essentially with materials which were grown by these three people indicated here. At the beginning of the story, these were powders of these materials, and the big progress comes from the fact that we are now able to work with single crystals, and this has been really the work of Ildar, who is the student who worked a lot on that point, and we are doing now very different experiments than what was done at the beginning. So to start, I'll try to outline what I'm supposed to speak about. So the title is Sodium Cobaltates, From Materials to Correlations and Topology. And you will see that the progression has been can be apparent in the work as it has been done. So I'll start by an introduction to the cobaltates. I'll try to present you the magnetic properties which at the beginning were the center of interest in our group. And I'll show how we found out the atomic order of the sodium by using techniques which are NMR and QR. And I'll show then how NMR allowed us to demonstrate that there is a charge disproportionation in these materials and that the magnetism on the local scale is measured by NMR techniques. And I'll arrive to this part, which is ongoing, in fact, which is a study of the transport properties on single crystals, and in which, in fact, I'll present, if I have time to do all that, I'll present work which we have been doing 15 days ago in the magnet lab in Tallahassee. So to start, let me try to introduce these materials. The cobaltates have been of great interest because they have applications. And the applications, you probably know that because the lithium cobaltates are materials which are part of the lithium batteries that are in all the computers you are having. All the electronics nowadays is working with lithium cobaltate. Not all, but I think in many batteries you have lithium cobaltate as a component of the battery. Why? Because the lithium moves. So at high temperature, the lithium moves, and so it's an ionic conductor. And the ionic conductivity is really the thing which is very important. And in fact, sodium cobaltate could become even more important in the future if one succeeds in doing batteries with sodium. As you can understand, lithium is very rather rare material, while the sodium is salt. That would be much cheaper to do sodium batteries. But the other aspects which I would like to indicate is that there is also large thermoelectric power, especially in the sodium cobalt single crystals. And this has been also a reason for which this material have been used. If you go to the physics, I'll try, of course, this is what is going to be of interest. There are ideas that you have spin entropy, you have high conductivity plus thermoelectric power, which is a good case for eventually using for Peltier cooling materials. So there are ideas that can come from the physics at the lowest temperatures. And one thing which has attracted at the beginning in 2004 is the fact that this superconductivity has been discovered. But one has to realize it has been discovered in a very special condition. These materials are very hygroscopic, so they suck water, they suck moisture. And if you let a sample suck moisture, you might reach a situation in which you have a superconductor, which is the material is transformed and has a superconductivity with TC equal 4K, not so important, but you will understand why this has a little bit interested people at that time. But I do not speak of superconductivity at all. So let us mention the structures of these materials, because these are important points, which indicates the large interest. These are layered materials, so it's really 2D materials in which you have cobalt oxygen planes separated by sodium layers or lithium layer for the lithium cobaltate, and the layered material is such that when you look from the top here, you have triangular lattice of cobalt. And this is a very important point. We are here speaking of frustration. The triangular lattice is something which is very important. So immediately when those were felt by the experimentalists, it was clear that this was the counterpart of the cuprates with a triangular lattice rather than a square lattice. And so that has really interested people at the beginning. Now, the point is that because of this layered structure, you have a high crystal field on the cobalt ions, which leads to a splitting of the 3D levels of the cobalt in the T2G and EG levels. And if you consider the possibilities for the charges for the cobalt, when it is 3+, you will have 6 electrons on the T2G level, which will be filled. And if it is 4+, you will have 5 electrons on the T2G level, and it will be a spin 1/2. So you see that you have a configuration in which you have something which you could consider as a band insulator if you are having a free plus configuration, while if you have a 4+ configuration, you get a half field level and you are in a Mott insulator. So this immediately tells you that there can be a connection with the cuprates. What should I do? Yeah. So the idea is very simple. You can change the sodium content. So if you change the sodium content, if you do a compound which is NaxCOO2, you are just going to fill the cobalt oxygen band, and it's exactly you can imagine that what will happen is exactly what happens in the cuprate. You have a Fermi surface and it's a metal. And in fact, the first experiments which were done on this material showed hexagonal Fermi surfaces. The hexagonal Fermi surfaces decrease the size when you increase the sodium content. And so you could think that you are just filling a band by doping. So there was a problem is that if you do LDA calculation from the structure, you find that you expect pockets which have never been seen by ARPES experiments. But all over, this could be a simple case where you dope, and you have to realize that here you are changing X from 0 to 1. You cannot cover the whole range, but you can cover a big range of doping, much larger than for the cuprates.
What is lifting the degeneracy of the TCG?
Sorry? Oh, this is you have the crystal field splitting also breaks this, so you could get a case where you have only one band, like the cuprate.
Yes, but what is breaking this TTP?
The symmetry of the crystal, with the crystal field of sodium. I'm not sure. Sorry, I cannot tell you exactly why. But this is not seen, huh? So let's forget it. So this is a very brief introduction. And immediately, this picture seems simple. You expect something which is going to be metals, and you would dope them. And questions, what about the magnetic properties? Are we beginning to feel things which have something to do with the situation encountered in the cuprates? And this point I am going to discuss now. Discuss the phase diagram which was proposed at the beginning. In fact, the analogy with the cuprates is rather simple to do, because if you start here at X equals 0, that is COO2, you have the Mott insulating state with cobalt 4+ only. And if you increase the sodium content, you increase it such that when you reach 1, it's a situation where you have only cobalt 3+, so you expect a band insulator there. So the simple idea which was considered at the beginning is that you would have the anti-ferromagnetic phase as for the cuprate around zero doping. And the superconductivity arrives at about 0.3. This is where it is found. So the analogy with the cuprates was rather simple to do, and this is what has been done in the first phase diagram which was proposed. You can see there is one anomaly in this phase diagram, which is at 1/2, something strange happens. This material does not correspond to the picture. But if you were really in a situation analogous to the cuprates, you would expect here to have a metallic phase, superconducting eventually, if the analogy can be pushed. But then, one of the very important things which immediately disturbs you is that here, in such an analogy, you would be here in a metal all over and progressively filling the band and having a purely metallic state. And in fact, that's not at all what is seen. After this boundary at X equal 1/2, you begin to find magnetism which appears, and especially magnetism appears in this regime. And this is seen, it has been seen in our group by muon spin resonance experiments. I am not going to explain the techniques, I'm sorry, but there are people of the group, young ones and older ones, who know perfectly that, and you could discuss with me or with them about the techniques which are used. So the MuSR is just telling you that you have magnetic moments, static magnetic moments in the system, and that you can see how these moments are increasing when you go at low temperature, and there are different phases depending where you are here, etc. So this is at least a problem, because you don't expect to see magnetism in this regime. This is very unusual. And you can see it by other ways. Another way is the NMR. Using the sodium NMR, you are measuring the susceptibility of the cobalt by transferred hyperfine fields. So what you are measuring here is a shift of the NMR resonance, which is often called the night shift in metals, in which you look at the variation of the susceptibility of the material through the shift. So what is plotted here is the shift versus temperature. And you see that here I am showing different concentrations, and you see that depending on the concentration, the behavior of the susceptibility changes quite a lot. And here, this part represents data taken for concentrations between 0.6, 2/3 and 0.77 or something like that. And here you see again the 2/3, but you see all this regime, which is for lower than 0.6, which would be, in fact, in absolute values, this would be here. But it's enlarged when you see it here. So this tells you immediately, because you have strange magnetic behavior, that there are important electronic correlations in the system, and you have to understand why, and why do you get this kind of behavior that you see everywhere. Okay, so that has led us to propose a phase diagram which is a little bit better at least which insists on the difference of physical properties. We have a parameter in NMR measurements. You can measure T1s, NMR shift. You can measure what is called the Coringa constant, which is the K2 T1T. Okay, this is a quantity which has which allows you to know whether the correlations in the system are ferromagnetic or anti-ferromagnetic. And we find that when you span the concentration, you switch from nearly ferromagnetic correlation to anti-ferromagnetic correlation going towards the low doping. So that allows you to show that the actual phase diagram on the magnetic side is bound to let you move from a ferromagnetically correlated material to anti-ferromagnetically correlated material. And I'll discuss the other things after. So that tells you that we have correlations in this system, and this is the first message I want to pass. The first take-home message that you have is to remind that these are correlated metals. They are metallic, and there are correlations. So this is an important point, which comes out from all these magnetic measurements. So what we have found then is that there is a dopant order. And I'll try to show you that by some experiments done especially using sodium NMR and cobalt NMR, but also X-rays eventually. So this is the next part of the talk. In principle, what has always said when working on the cuprates is that the physical properties of the cuprates are associated with the cobalt oxygen layer that you dope. And that you dope because you do some chemistry somewhere which allows you to inject holes or electrons in the cobalt oxygen plane. the reality is that the material is not a single layer. It's a complicated story, for instance, SIPCO. You have the layers, but you have interlayers. You have you are playing with chemistry inside. Here again, it's the same. You would like to speak, and all the calculations I have shown you, well, I didn't show the calculations, but the results of the calculation of band structure, etc., were done assuming a cobalt oxygen plane, which is uniform and which you dope by injecting the electrons that the sodium give to the cobalt oxygen planes. So the real materials are more complicated because you have the sodium dopants which are sitting in between the layers. And what are doing these sodium dopants? Of course, they are important because they fix the structure. Without those, you would the system would not remain lamellar as it is, and it's the same for the cuprates. So the interlayers are there and allow you to stack these 2D layers. What has been seen early on very tiny grains of powders of the sodium cobaltate is that if you looked at the transmission electron microscopy, you found that there is an incipient order in between, of which indicates that the sodium is not totally at random in the interlayers. So this was a point, and in fact, we have been working quite heavily trying to understand that on the material side. This is shown here. What we have tried to do is X-ray, very careful X-ray, and all the data which were taken were such that on powders, you found peaks and you found values of the C parameter, which were, you couldn't vary that continuously. That is, if you try to change the chemical content of your material, you grind it and you grow the powder, you realize that you had some regions where you couldn't stabilize a clean phase and some regions in which you had clean phases. So this seems to indicate somewhere that only some composition give stable phases. And this has been it has been quite clear that we had some regimes where you had composition gaps in which you couldn't stabilize the phase with some values of the sodium content. And this is shown beautifully by this NQR experiment in which I present what are the NQR spectra. I hope that you will have time to see Quentin or Brandan or Fabrice to try to learn about what one can do with nuclear spins. What we do with nuclear spin here, it's nuclear spins not in a field, which are non-one-half spins, and a nucleus which is not one-half has the form of a cigar. It's not a silent. It's not a sphere. It's a small cigar. There is what one calls a quadrupole moment, and this quadrupole moment of the nucleus couples to the electrostatic field, not to the field, but to the gradient of the field, and that allows you to get an information on the organization of the charges around the nucleus. And in fact, so when you look at, you can look at spectra, which gives you a number of sites and which you can disentangle and you can understand. What is important here is not to understand anything about the spectra. The only thing is you have here one, two, three, four phases, and you see the spectra of the four phases seen on NQR are totally different. You have absolutely nothing in common between this spectrum and this spectrum, or this spectrum and this spectrum. They are extremely different, and they are very well resolved, very narrow line, which indicates there is a perfect order in the system. So this is very interesting, and you see here we are sitting in between 0.72 and this one. This is a here we are in between 0.71 and 0.72. This spectrum is a superposition of these two. You can easily find out that you track the two. So when you are in a forbidden range of concentration, you get a mixture of phases, and well, that is very well understood in chemistry. When you have two phases which are stable apart, if you try to do the something intermediate, it demixes and it gives you the two phases. And this is a very, very important information. It tells us that these systems do only like to be ordered. And you cannot succeed in getting a phase which is intermediate between two ordered phases. And that is going to be extremely important in the follow-up. So the NQR, so I want to show you one phase. I am going to discuss one phase among all. As you have seen, you have many phases, and I want to discuss only one, because this is the one on which we have been extremely far, and we have understood many things using NMR techniques. And this phase is the two-thirds. It's exactly the composition X equal two-thirds, that is Na two-thirds CO2. And there, if you look at the NQR, you find that you have three sodium sites and four cobalt sites, very well defined. They were very well resolved. All that can be explained why the detection allows us to get this, but what the information we have is that these phases are very well, this phase is very well ordered and has three sodium sites and four cobalt sites. And we have played to try to understand how this could happen, and I am not going to do the demonstration here, but what we have shown is that this is the structure of the Na of the sodium plane. The sodium can be red, that is, can be at the vertical of a triangle of cobalt. Here, the black lines are the triangles of cobalt, and the balls are the sodium. And so what we did find clearly is that you have Na1 sites, which are the ones which are on the top of a cobalt, and the green sites which are on the top of a triangle of, and this is the arrangement which we have guessed. In fact, we have completely guessed that gives us the three sites. You have one green, two green, one dark, one clear, and the red. And we could completely define the full structure of this material by the information we have on the cobalt lines and sodium lines. Okay, this, if you read the paper, you will understand perfectly how we could arrive that. And we used arguments connected with the symmetry of the sites, etc. Okay, I don't enter into the details. What I want to show you is that this is a very unique case where X-rays were unable to give us the structure, but after we had guessed the structure from the NMR, we did succeed in getting the X-ray spectrum and to show exactly that it fitted with the model we had. And this was the reason it's not so easy, because the sodium has a weak scattering in the X-ray, so what you see mostly is due to the cobalt oxygen triangles. So this dominates the peaks of the spectra, but you have very tiny peaks which are in between, which we indexed completely, and we show that our structure is perfect, and we understand it perfectly. Okay, why is that phase interesting? It's interesting now for many reasons. So I'll concentrate on that phase. On that phase, we have been measuring the magnetic properties, and this shows up a susceptibility which behaves like Curie-Weiss. Plot chi versus one over chi versus t gives us a negative intercept. There is some anti-ferromagnetic correlations. And what is very interesting is that the susceptibility increases dramatically and saturates at low temperature. This is an enlargement of this here. And we have shown that there is no magnetic ordering till the lowest temperature, even checked by MuSR down to 10 mK. So this is a very strange metal. This is a metal which has a response with a susceptibility which peaks below T equal to 2 degrees. The scale is not obvious here, but I don't know. Here it's 4K.
Henri?
Oui,
hein? Can you tell us something about the specific heat capacity of this material?
It has been measured. It has been measured and it behaves. You could imagine, and I'll show after the measurement of resistivity, etc., that you have, you could think that you reach a spin liquid here. No, that's, a Fermi liquid here with a characteristic temperature of 2K. So this is the. Yeah. So I have shown you that this phase has some interest in itself, and now I show you how the susceptibilities measured by the sodium NMR, even or by susceptibility itself, how they behave. So this is the two-thirds, the one which peaks very high. And you see the other phases are very different. Their susceptibilities can be extremely different depending of the content, the sodium content. And this indicates that these materials are very different ground states, although we are moving, well, from 0.5 to 0.77, for instance. So we are covering a range of concentration which is not that large, but we change totally the physics. And that is an important point. And of course, you have to begin to think that this is connected to the order of the sodium. So the second thing to bring home, if you miss everything, just remember this, the sodium ordering influences the magnetic properties. Yeah. Not of cobalt, of sodium. Huh? We change.
Yeah? Is possible to detect all these things?
No, we have done NMR of cobalt, and that it is the next step, and it will show you that there are very interesting effects which come out of that. So I am still in 2008 or 2009. So, as I say, the sodium ordering influences the magnetic properties. And when we measure through the sodium NMR, we get an information. Sodium is coupled to many cobalt above it, which are in the plane, in the two planes. So it gives you an average of the susceptibility. It's quite analogous as measuring the actual susceptibility, except that it ensures that you select the right phase because you take the right sodium signal. So now I switch to the next step. Can we say that the cobalts are identical in the material? Because all this, and this has been the case in the cuprates for years and years, everybody assumes that the plane is doped and you have a band and you forget about the dopants, etc., and you have something which is very uniform. Here, we are going to measure the cobalt NMR. So you see, it's complicated. It's a big business to understand these kind of things. And again, if you want to try to understand how we could disentangle the things, just go to see Brandon and Fabrice or or Quentin, and they will go through the papers and try to understand. At least they have the language, they know the technique, and they are young, so they will understand. But anyway, sorry, I have to go back. So the spectra are complicated, but we know what we are doing. We use our technique very well. It's a paper 2011. Huh? So we could disentangle all that, and simple. We knew we have four sides. This is two-thirds, the phase in which we have determined the structure. We know everything on the structural side. But now we measure the cobalt sides. We know that we have four sides because we have seen by NQR that we had four sides. So we measured the NMR on this system, and what did we find? We found, in fact, four signals in NMR with different shifts. One is an interesting case, as you can see here. This is the shift of the NMR versus temperature. So remember, this system has a susceptibility which hits the ceiling. Eh? And here, nothing. So there are sites. In fact, there are two sites, the two cobalt 1A, cobalt 1B. These two sites have no magnetism. Their susceptibility is flat. So they do not follow what you see macroscopically. Then you have two other sites, so we have four sites, as I said, and these two sites has a susceptibility which looks like what I have shown for the macroscopic thing. So this tells you that you have two types of cobalt in your material and that they behave totally differently. One is non-magnetic at all, and the other one is seeing all the magnetism. It's like if the bands on these cobalts are not the same. Typically, you can say that this one, being non-magnetic, is in a configuration where the six levels are filled. So in some sense, the T2G level of these cobalts is below the Fermi level. The other case, it's the opposite. You have a large susceptibility, so that means there is large density of state of electrons there. That means the band is not full, and you have the metallic character is on these two sites. So we have now four sites. We know them very well. And in fact, if you look at the plane, we know the structure. We just realize the two sites which are magnetic are nearly the same behavior, and the sites which are non-magnetic are the same behavior. So if you look at the actual triangular structure of your system, you isolate the sites which are non-magnetic, and you have other ones which are magnetic, which leads you with a simple count, the intensities of the line, etc., etc. I don't enter into the details, which leads you to say that the structure is a metallic Kagome lattice, in which the sites which are in between which are the complementary sites of the Kagome lattice in the triangular lattice are non-magnetic, and the electrons are delocalized on the other sites with about a filling of 0.4 for a hole per site. This is what comes out of that. So you see, the situation is very original because, apart the fact that it's a Kagome lattice, it is a situation in which you have a strong disproportionation. That is, the charges of the sites are not the same. The cobalt differentiate totally. Nothing to do one with each other. And then you begin to understand that we have extended this kind of analysis to all the concentration range, and our phase diagram is completely different nowadays. There is a part which is ferromagnetically correlated, in which we find that there is charge ordering. And we found that below 0.5, in fact, the doping is, in that case, homogeneous. All the cobalt behave the same. It's rather a uniform system, while this one is charge ordered with big disproportionation. So I think this phase diagram is dead in that sense, because it has it doesn't have the essential points, which is that when you have charge ordering, you have ferromagnetic correlations, and you have anti-ferromagnetic correlation when you are in a regime which is rather homogeneous at lower dopamine. So what about that? I do a small digression to the cuprates, because you have all seen that in the last 10 years there has been a huge effort to understand the charge density wave orders, etc., which are found in the cuprate, which have been found for the last 10 years. There is a big business which has been done around the fact that you have 2-3D or 2D charge order depending of the condition. This is the IPCO phase diagram. It's seen by different techniques. Maybe the people who will speak of superconductivity will mention that. I don't know. I just want to show you what that means. That means that if you look at the present phase diagram, which is very often presented nowadays, which has a very great complexity, I have claimed, knowing all these results on the cobaltate, I have always claimed for long, 10 years ago, that the pseudogap line was well above all these charge orders. And at the beginning, nobody accepted the idea, but progressively the phase diagram refined, and everybody agrees nowadays that the pseudogap line is an important generic property, which is an important generic property which lies high in temperature, and below the pseudogap line you begin to get this static type of charge orders which appear. And what does that mean? If you look really at the case of the IPCO, this happens at a range which is 0.12, typically, of doping, and 0.12 is 1/8. So one strong argument, which I have always insisted for a long time, is that this charge order was associated with the ordering of the oxygen in the dopant layers. So my message, and that's the third message I want you to keep when going home, is dopants are not vegetables. The dopants are affecting the properties of the material. So when you do chemistry, and unfortunately we are forced to do chemistry, be careful. Be careful, the dopants are acting. They are not only vegetables sending their carriers in the plains, they are also affecting the properties. In the case of the cobaltates, it's absolutely tremendous situation, because you have sites which are totally non-magnetic as compared to others which are magnetic, which feel the delocalization of the electrons. But the cuprates is similar in some sense. And in fact, all these charge orders depend on the material and are stabilized in some cases. They are competitors to superconductivity in some cases, etc., etc. So again, dopants are not vegetables. Okay, so I don't know, I still have some time. Huh? I can maybe finish by actual things. So I am going now to tell you, since all that story, we have been able to grow single crystals in which we controlled sodium content by electrochemistry. And so we have been able to synthesize materials which are with the well-known phase sodium contents that we had established on the powder. We are able to produce them in very nice single crystals. To show you that, for instance, I show you just the resistivity curves of two phases with the two-thirds, and this one, which is 077. What you see here are the resistivity curves, and you see they are very different, of course, but for the two materials. But what you can see is that there are different colors. And the different colors on these curves are different batches of samples done independently, using the same techniques, of course. But that means you have a reproducibility which is remarkable on this. The reproducibility can be seen not only on the resistivity, but on the derivative of the resistivity. You see the derivatives are absolutely identical here. Here, this one has a transition at 22K, which is an anti-ferromagnetic transition. So we have very good samples, and we are able to do very good experiments, I think. So which kind of experiments we do? I recall you what we have seen, for instance, on the susceptibilities. We have been able to characterize some phases to see very, very clear behaviors of the magnetic responses, but we did the same on the transport. Now that we have single crystals in which we can do the transport correctly, we can see the resistivities, and you can see how the resistivities differ for different phases. The colors are match, so that is each phase has its counterpart, and this is the Hall effect. And here again, you see that the behavior of the Hall effect is very different. And why do I mention Hall effect? Well, you know, Hall effect is a quantity which tells you a lot about the band structure of the material, maybe the topology behind, etc., etc. So this is where we arrive. So that's why I want to detail a little bit some research of the Hall effect on two phases, on which we worked a lot recently, the two-thirds and the 0.77. This one is anti-ferromagnetic. This one is the two-thirds, the famous one. And as you can see, the Hall effect is positive at high temperature, becomes negative for the 67. For the other one, it remains positive. And then there is behavior at low temperature, which is astonishing. So you wonder whether this is a crazy story and your samples are bad. But no, the Hall effect is perfectly reproducible. This is the two-thirds phase, three samples, black, blue, red, the data, perfectly reproducible with all the singularities that you can see there. So we are bound. If you start with a positive Hall effect, which is what you expect with the Fermi surface, which is hexagonal, and you switch to a negative, it means that you begin to be in a two-band system, something, well, that's one interpretation. You could think that you need negative carriers so you have a change you have to build a model to try to understand that. But then what's happening? The ground state is even completely astonishing. So we don't understand so far. But we will understand. and of course, once we find these kind of things, we begin to wonder what's happening with the field. Are these materials good metals? What can you do? And so we did experiments in Tallahassee and Toulouse. In Tallahassee, up to 45 Tesla. This is a result of experiments which we did 15 days ago. So you see, there is no danger. I can submit the data. Nobody will compete and will try to compete. Nobody is interested. But we are crazy, so we are crazy. So we are still doing. And look at the results that we obtained. It's very interesting. This is the resistivity versus field up to 45 Tesla. And you see how the resistivity, the magnetoresistance, which is negative at low temperature, positive at low temperature, becomes negative at high temperature. This is the Hall effect. It's the Hall voltage, so the slope here, the thing I showed you, which was a very negative Hall effect, it's the linear part here at low fields, so the linear parts, and then, whoop, the Hall effect changes sign. So this, again, is telling you something. You even can see that there are quantum oscillations which appear there on the Hall effect, but we see it also on the transport, etc. So what I can say is that a field induces drastic changes, and a field which is not that large, 45 Tesla, it's 40 degrees, it's few millieves. So we are in a situation in which we affect the band structure very easily, so that means there are refined flat bands somewhere in this material. There is no way to explain that elsewhere. Oh, sorry, what, she doesn't want to move anymore? Ah, yes. Yeah, I wanted to say what I have said. In fact, we see quantum oscillations in this two-third phase very nicely, that we measure to much higher fields in Toulouse, and we see the quantum oscillations perfectly. We can analyze them quite nicely as well. I'm not sure. Yeah, they are crazy. I didn't do an animation. Sorry. So, for instance, here the two-third phase has two frequencies. We analyze that perfectly. The people who know about quantum oscillations will understand the graphs without problem. I could show the temperature dependencies, etc. All this is so recent that I just show raw data as it came up of the experiment. For the 077, we have a single frequency. This is frequencies in 1 over b of the Fourier transform of the quantum oscillations, which tell you about the orbits in of the Fermi surface. So we are on the verge to try to understand, but at least what I show you is that there are very interesting phenomena which occur, and which in which you have no good way to understand the origin. I show you this also because this is also data that we got two weeks ago, which is on the phase x equal 1/2. And on the phase x equal 1/2, we find very, very strange behavior with a big first order transition which occurs at 40 Tesla. It's a chance that it occurs there, because if it was 70, we wouldn't see it. So we have a situation where you have a big, in the low temperature phase of this material, which is very special, you get a phase transition which occurs in field. Here again, 40 Tesla is not that large field, so it means that we are dealing with very narrow band details which are affecting the properties. I am not able to tell you the situation and the interpretation at this stage, but at least I show you that there are drastic phenomena which occur in these systems. So, I am in time. Short. I am in time. Well, good. So I can even make a conclusion. So, usually I do not succeed doing that, but this time I am being rather good. So, charge order. One thing very important which comes out of this experiment, which I have always insisted about, is that be careful when you speak of the cube rate, of the charge orders, etc. The influence of the dopants cannot be neglected. They are very important, and the cobaltates show you a situation which is extreme, in which the ordering of the dopants is driving totally the physics and making that the different phases are very different. In fact, if I was still in activity, I could probably have two or three students, one on each phase, because each phase has some peculiarities which are worth working on. So it wouldn't be a problem. The other point, this is the case of the cobalt, of the cobaltate, is precisely this one. We have large cobalt disproportionation which occurs and which is connected with the sodium atomic order. We have a great variety of original ground original metallic ground states. We have the need, and this is the real point, we will advance when we will have good band structure calculations using the actual structures that we have. And we have a situation in which the unit cells are large enough. Even the two-thirds has already four cobalt sites. So for people doing DMFT and things like that, which has to incorporate the correlation, which is required to incorporate the correlations, This is a little bit complicated, but it's at the edge of what they can do. So there is a big hope that they will be able to do that and to provide us band structure calculation, which will allow us to understand whether we have whale points or Dirac cones or anything like that. We are in materials which could show up that. So at this stage, we don't know which is the relative importance of the correlations of topology, because, of course, the courses that you heard were on topological materials which were non-correlated. Here we are dealing with both correlations and topology. So I have another message to pass, which I think is important, which is, you can read it. Do not search under the lamp of the lanterns. The interesting phenomena are usually in the shadow after the lanterns. Okay. Thank you very much for. And if there are questions, I am quite open to try to answer. Yes. Because you have the sodium has, of course, some calculations have been done which show that these kind of phases that we find are reasonable, because the electrostatic interaction between the sodium ions play a role in the cohesion of the material. So the cohesion of the material is driven by the order somewhere. Well, at least the order of the sodium plays a role in defining the cohesion of the material and in stabilizing the phases. Oh, they are no, they are quasi 2D. The conductivity is extremely poor in the C direction. They are metallic in layers, and in fact, in the magnetism, the magnetic phases, I didn't describe them. But the layers are ferromagnetically coupled, usually. For instance, the phase which I call the 22K phase, the cobalts which are magnetic in that phase are ferromagnetic in plane and anti-ferromagnetic from plane to plane, with a weak coupling, of course, between layers.
And does the sodium change that interaction, or how does that play a role?
Okay, I am pushing people to try to do pressure experiments to try to modulate these kind of things. This is part of the program. So when I find the right persons. Yes? Oh, in fact, we don't. In the experiments we have on the quantum oscillations, it's always that small pocket, because the order of the cobalt, the disproportionation of the cobalt leads you to unit cells which are much larger than the triangular unit cell of the cobalt oxygen. So what you are measuring is totally reconstructed. I have to give a remark. All the data which I showed, which were showing pockets, are ARPES, and which were showing the hexagonal. And ARPES is a surface probe. When you cleave these materials, you are not sure that the sodium order is preserved. So you probably realize this kind of disorder of the sodium, which leads to a disorder in the plane. And so this, we are not dealing with the same material. The 3D material has nothing to do with the surface. Yes. Yes. Okay. No. Transmission electron.
Oh, okay. Can you go back to the?
What?
Can you go back to the images?
Probably. Probably. I have to check whether the thing is. It's at the beginning.
Okay.
It's the beginning. Should I? Sorry, he brings me back to the first. First transparency. This.
Yeah. So you have some satellite peaks.
Yeah.
Your main peaks.
Yeah.
What is the origin of those peaks?
It's the order of the sodium.
The order of the sodium.
Okay. Yeah.
Oh, so the bright peaks are the positions of the cobalt.
Cobalt, yeah.
Oh, okay. Cool.
Yes. Ah, that's enough. lithium does. I'm convinced that lithium does the same, but lithium, the mobility of lithium is apparently larger. But nobody did as carefully the lithium case, and one could do it. I am pretty sure we could do it. But you know, we are not going to do a forest of materials. There are not. There is enough questions. Here. Huh? Yes?
So, okay, so you fix a certain, or you have some kind of doping for the sodium atoms that you fix, and then you can basically drive some thermal motion of the cobalt atoms using.
No, the cobalt are not moving at all.
Moving at all.
No, it's the sodium which can move.
The sodium?
Yeah, the way the samples, the single crystal samples are done is electrochemistry. That is, you do a single crystal of the highest concentration you can, and then you do electrochemistry to displace the sodium and to evacuate it. And you have voltage plateaus which tells you the stable phases.
So you can actually see the
sodium. So you can, with a starting single crystal which is concentrated, you can synthesize all the phases one after the other if you want. But in fact, you do one and you keep it. and you do all the measurements. Yes?
You showed the susceptibility and you mentioned that there were specific heat measurements. Used to understand how this local moment behavior gives rise to some kind of Fermi equilibrium.
For me, because of the sodium ordering, the level, the 3D levels are differentiated in space, which makes that some of the cobalts have their 3D level moved down to field. So those can be considered as not local moments, but impurity states in which the cobalt has become a vegetable. The other ones are in the band.
So what's the origin of the local moments then? No,
the behavior and susceptibility.
Mm-hmm.
It's narrow bands. We are in a correlated system. You could say heavy fermion.
So how am I to understand the delocalized electrons and the localized moments in this system?
No, we don't have I don't think we have localized moments.
Beautiful Curie
supposedly. They are not Curie, they saturate. Fermi
yes,
liquid.
Yeah,
it's like Kondo.
So if I think of it that way.
Yeah. No, it's a correlated state of matter which has large susceptibility, large density of states in some sense. So you could see it as a Kondo resonance peak.
Then you should see extraordinarily large masses than the
Aspen. We have the 2/3 precisely has orbits with eight electronic masses. Ah, no, no, it's not. Okay, maybe.
Okay, thank you.
There is work to do for theoreticians. we have done a lot of work. There is a lot of things. No other question? If you have, yeah, one more. No, 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 no. The Kagome is at 2/3. Okay. Elsewhere is different. You change completely the pattern when you go to higher. We are not able to map all the patterns. We understood some of them, but we have to understand the physics after we'll enter the details of the variation of the patterns. That okay? Thank you very much.